buildup for me, and probably selfishly, as many of you know, I'm Dave Hooke. I run a team here at the Keller Williams Central PA Market Center, and just so excited to be on with these three panelists about team building. It's called Strength in Numbers. So we are going to ask lovingly these three panelists, Chris, Lance, and Linzee, questions about their journey in building a team. And we're going to try to get into some of the good, the bad, and the ugly, and if they're comfortable with it, and everything in between, because often we learn most from the challenges and the failures, and we all have some of those along with our successes. So for the next hour, we'll go through three different types of questions, some general questions at the start about each panelist, and then we'll get into the nuts and bolts of their team, and then maybe some advice they can leave us with at the end. As you guys have questions, just put them in the chat. We'll do our best to field the questions. I'm not going to target any specific panelists. They, you know, they're in different seasons of their team's journey. So we'll learn, you know, they each have different challenges and wins to share in their journey. So they'll know when they are suited to answer a question. But if you have a question for a specific panelist, just put their name in the chat and we'll do our best then to redirect that to them. So guys, thanks for being here. Lance, Chris, and Linzee, we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yep. And we'll just get started. If you could just introduce yourselves. You know, on my screen, Chris, you're first. So we'll go Chris, Lance, then Linzee. Okay. So introduce yourselves. Give us one thing about you personally, would be awesome. And then maybe how long you've been growing a team, what your role is today, and then just your team dynamics, production, size of team, that sort of thing.
Awesome. We'll leave the best for last of these three. So, all right, cool. So I'm out of the Exton office. I think one thing about me personally, I've been married, it'll be 19 years in July. I have four kids ranging from 15 to 5, two boys and two girls. And love health, CrossFit, just took up a rollerblading again, like going to skate parks and stuff like that. If you follow me on Facebook, you can't miss it. So that's a lot of fun. Been growing a team since 2010. I have a business partner, Caleb Connect, and he's our Market Center's team leader. He has been for a little over a year and a half. And my role in the business is a CEO. I'm the CEO, so I oversee, you know, the growth and direction of the team. And I spend about 20 hours a week in my business. The other 20 hours I spend coaching amazing people like the amazing Mike DeRemer. And team dynamic size, we've got about 10, 11 people on the team, depending on what day it is. And we closed 182 sides for between 55 and 60 million in volume. That's 182, you know, deals for about 1.5 million in GCI revenue. So I think that's pretty much it.
Awesome. I love the rollerblade story. It sounds dangerous, but thanks for sharing, Chris. Lance, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hi, I'm Lance Loken in the Houston metropolitan area of Texas. We just celebrated our 10th year in business. We started January 2011. Karina, my wife, had been in the business for about 2 years prior to that. She was also an interim team leader for a year during that time. And then when she got back into the business, we started the Loken Group together. A little fact about me, I was the number one piano player in the state of Wisconsin in my seventh grade year. And I don't play piano at all anymore, but it was fun while it lasted. We have 85 people on the team, 70 are TLG in the United States. And then we have 15 virtual partners that are in the Philippines. And last year we did 2,514 transactions for $668 million. And we're on track to do about $850 million this year.
That's always sort of earth shattering when I hear it. And I've heard Lance talk on many panels, and every time I hear it, it's just, it's a amazing accomplishment for the last 10 years. And I don't know whether that's more impressive or the piano story. little known fact, that was good information. Linzee, thanks for coming on today. Best for last, tell us about yourself.
I don't know. This is hard competition, right? I'm Linzee Ciprani, for anybody who doesn't know me. So My claim to fame is that I started with Matt Fetick back in 2013 and I was growing his team. So I'm a little bit different because I started on operations and then went out on my own. And my team has been in existence for about 5 years only. And so last year we hit 40 million, which was a goal that I'd been shooting for and wanted to hit in my fifth year. So that was key. We closed 135 transactions, had a 42% profit, also key and something that I like talking about. And I also own Ciprani Consulting. Ciprani Consulting hires and trains all things real estate. And we are the number one recruiter and we're almost hitting 3,000 hires with Ciprani Consulting in the real estate world, which is super fun and is where we're very passionate about helping people leverage. Personally, I am a wife to Steve Ciprani, who is now in Ciprani Consulting with me and he's amazing with recruiting. And then I have two beautiful little girls. I have Emmy and Alexis, and they are 6 and 8 and just a total handful, but they came from me, so that makes sense. And so I'll give you a little weird fact. I won the silver medal in a tetrathlon, which is shooting bow and arrow, riding horses, and swimming. And I did that for 3 years in a row back when I was younger. So
wow, I think between the piano player and the rollerblader, you have them both beat for sure. And I love the 42% profit number because it is a challenge, right? We know that any size team, like that's a big challenge because you have overhead and it's a different thing than sales for sure. So congratulations with that. So Linzee, why don't we start with you and we'll go back the other way. Just so you know, the way that we came up with these questions is I contacted a bunch of people in our market and I asked if there was one thing you could ask a massively successful team owner that you would want to know, what would it be? And then we just kind of compiled these questions. So one of the questions that came up a lot, and I know we have a lot of independent agents on here, somebody with an assistant who's just, you know, maybe contemplating making that jump. At what point did you decide to start a team? And maybe what are some of the signs for an independent agent to consider taking that step?
Yeah. Well, this is, again, what I'm super passionate about. So I think almost all of us on the panel here, we all wanted to do a team right away, as far as I know. And here's the truth behind that. I truly believe that we are not doing a really great job for our clients if we don't have some leverage. So whether that means a transaction coordination company that's coming alongside of us and taking that, or a runner or a sign deliverer or something, right? We don't need to be doing all of those things that are way below our pay grade. And so, I wanted to start a team right away. So as soon as I went out on my own, I had a virtual assistant immediately, but that's also who I am. So don't forget that. And I leveraged pretty quickly all the things I knew I didn't need to do, which is what catapulted me and got me to where I am as quickly as it did, right? Because I know that if I can offload those things, that I can grow and double my business easily, because it frees me up to just do sales, right? How would you know? So if you're not spending time with your family, right? If you are constantly tied to your phone, if you are feeling burned out right now, if you are, you know, looking, if you're sitting in the car and putting a sign in the ground, mm-hmm. like if you're actually doing that yourself, there's so many of those things that I just want to challenge you to go, gosh, if I could just offload that, right? I would have this much more time, right? And I just start writing those things down and seeing how long they're taking you and consider offloading it.
Yeah, and we've all been there, right? So I can relate. Lance or Chris, anything to add to when you start a team, or signs that you know, the right reasons that people should start considering?
Go ahead, Lance.
Oh, okay. Yes, we started the team from day one. We actually used our babysitter in March of our first year to do our transactions piece of it, because she was a high C and Karina and I are not high C's whatsoever. So we leveraged that. And the rule of thumb for us was whatever activity costs $20 or less an hour, we're going to leverage that up. And that was our rule of thumb as far as and also getting to more and more of an expert piece of the business. We wanted to have an organization of experts throughout the entire business process so that our clients would have the best of the best at all times, instead of having somebody that wore multiple hats. And so that was how we grew the business.
Yeah, that's awesome. Great. Chris, anything to add?
Yeah, I mean, I started out on a team as a buyer's agent marketing person. I went to art school. I'm an SC on the disc, Enneagram 5. You know, I'm not the typical salesperson. And so, you know, when I went to Bold in 2009, I got a vision for what could be possible when you actually follow the models, right? And so my business partner and I started our team with the idea that we'd follow the models and do things as best we could according to that, which is not the easiest thing in the world. And so that's, you know, the passion of wanting to do things better than the team I was on, per se, and that, you know, come to find out that's a lot harder than it looks. And I'll say, you know, I love Glantz's rule about $20 an hour. I'd say that, you know, going to what both of them have said, as far as the specialties, right? You know, I mentioned, you know, SC on the disc, Enneagram, you know, 5, like everybody has their personality and what they're good at. And most of us, if we're great at sales, really suck at the admin. Let's just be honest, right? We're not great at the details. And so your clients are not getting the best experience. And to hold on to that is selfish, and it's putting your clients at a disadvantage. You're giving a lower level of service than if you found somebody that could offset your weaknesses and make them strengths.
And maybe even keeping opportunity from someone else who's better at that than you are too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I heard that a couple of times, like that the client will actually get better service. So we get this control issue that we need to do everything this way. And that may be a myth. And I'm hearing that clients actually get better service when you're not doing everything yourself. I love that. I'd love to just jump in before we get to nuts and bolts, which there's going to be a ton of value in the nuts and bolts for everybody on this call. But before we do that, I would love to just hear each one of you, if you could share as vulnerably as possible, the biggest mistake that you think that you made in business, or a failure that mm-hmm. you could share that we might all learn from.
Mm. I'll go first, since we're kind of going back and forth here. I'm all about authenticity, so I'm an open book. I'll share just about anything. Honestly, I think one of the biggest mistakes is not investing in myself more earlier. I became a MAPS coach about 2.5-3 years ago. And in the last 2.5-3 years, it's been the biggest growth experience of my life. And our business has shown that. So, you know, really one of the bigger mistakes is not investing more in myself, or rather, I wasn't ready to be a MAPS coach when I started the team, obviously. And yet understanding that your business really grows to the extent that you do. You are, you know, if you're not investing in yourself, if you're not being humble enough to learn from the mistakes that you're making and to hear about your mistakes from other people, you're stunting your growth. And a great example of that is this. In 2017, end of 2017, I got out of production and I was going to hire for our team. We had a P&L. I thought it was clear. Turns out it wasn't. We weren't making the profit that we thought we were. And in 2018, that was one of the hardest financial years of my life, because there was, you know, it cost about 100 grand to 120 grand, depending on the year, to run our family. And I think I only earned, you know, $60,000-$70,000 that year. So I put a lot of money in debt. I went through our emergency funds and our credit cards. I put money on our credit cards. And, you know, I just wasn't clear on the numbers from a profit standpoint. And we switched bookkeepers. We got all of our ducks in a row. We read profit first and implemented that. And within 5 short months of June of 2019 to November of 2019, we went from having almost no money in the bank as a business to having $200,000 in the bank.
Wow.
Right. It changed our lives. And so from a mistake standpoint, I should have paid attention to the models earlier, right? One of the things I really love to coach to is profit and loss. That's why I love to teach profit camp, which I did yesterday. And that's really important. If you don't begin with profit early on in your business and understand the model of 30-30-40 with, you know, 30% cost of sales, 30% operating expenses, 30% profit, and the splits you're giving your team, including yourself as a production agent, you're headed for a disaster like I was. So that was one of the mistakes that I made.
That's really good. Thanks for the vulnerability. Yeah, it's I think we look at teams and we're like, it's always an easy journey. And yet there's these times we go through that are just some of the toughest seasons in our lives. And that's a great example. Lance, what do you have?
Which day, which week? the biggest one, and again, I would never change our business and our journey, but in the first year of business, you know, we had big goals right away. And in September of 2011, Ben Kinney was up on stage talking about this amazing home race. And essentially what you do is you get a whole bunch of open houses together and go through the open houses, answer clues, and whoever answered the most clues at the end of the event won $10,000 cash. So here we are, we're just starting out the Loken Group, we're $250,000 in debt. We're gonna go and do this amazing home race. It's gonna cost $70,000 that we didn't have. So we dove headfirst into it and got to the event, had a game plan of having 5,000 people attend that event, had less than 150, and the whole thing fell flat on its face. We lost all of that. The next month, our house goes into foreclosure proceedings. And so as bad as that was, the two things that happened, it was it gave us a ton of exposure and it catapulted us into the next stage. By July, we had 100,000 GCI month. And so we were able to pay off all the debt. And, you know, now today we're completely debt free. But that was a gigantic mistake or floundering that happened, but it catapulted us forward.
It's amazing. And I heard in both of those experiences, it was the biggest struggle. And yet in both of those experiences, I saw a big leap forward for in both of your lives and businesses, which is awesome. Linzee, what's your story?
Yeah, you know, I'd love to have a different one than them, but I really feel like finances as entrepreneurs, like we just really struggle in that area. And it's funny, in my real estate team, there's a book. It tells me what to do. I follow it. I never deviated from it. Like I was really good about being like, this is what we do. This is how we code it. And I had this playbook, right? With the Millionaire Real Estate Agent book. In my consulting business, I did not. That was a very different world. And I didn't man the store and really watch my finances there. And so I started robbing from Peter to pay Paul, like all those things that we talk about. You know, I would move money over to the other business. And before I knew it, Ciprani Consulting last year was in $120,000 worth of debt going into a pandemic. And it was like literally probably the worst moment of my life because, you know, we're consulting and hiring, right? Nobody wanted to hire. No, and everybody was like, give me my money back, which was an interesting time. And then everybody wanted to cut their consulting. And we're not coaching. It's very different. I look at it very different. And so, you know, immediately we went like that. And I had gone into that year with a massive amount of debt. And it's because I wasn't manning the store. And I think a lot of the times we can, as entrepreneurs, we can dabble in a lot of different things and have a lot of different businesses and a lot of, you know, all these different things that we're doing a little bit in. And before we know it, we didn't, you know, it only took me 3 or 6 months of really not looking at my sales in that business and really holding my salespeople accountable. Again, different model, different business, very, you know, salaried, bonuses, all those things. I wasn't holding them accountable. So then when we hit that, it was a complete disaster. And we had to climb out of that and become really profitable really fast and figure it all out. And so probably, you know, last year was probably the hardest year of my life, just in both businesses. It was like, okay, we're gonna slash all the expenses. We're gonna, you know, go down to the bare minimum. What can we do here? And it was every day push, push, push. And we came out on top in both of those businesses, but probably the hardest thing I've ever been through.
Wow. Thanks so much for sharing that. And so the theme, you know, if I'm a independent agent, we'll get to this question in a little bit. What are some of the differences? But one of the things I'm hearing is if I'm an independent agent, I have to be a good salesperson. And that's a skill set in its own. One of the things we should be prepared for if we're thinking about starting a team, having more overhead, is how to master the skill set around finances sooner rather than later. It sounds like all three of you, that was part of your journey. Thanks for sharing that. We're going to go on through to another section just to give really practical questions. And I know, full disclaimer, anybody listening to this, that the answer to a lot of these questions, we have a MAPS coach, Chris, on the call, is it depends on your market. It depends on your team. And you want to be really careful taking the answers to these next questions and applying it to every situation, because it might not apply. And yet we do have questions that came out that they want to hear what these answers are for you guys. Some of them are going to apply to everybody on the call. Other are going to be market specific. And I just want to put that disclaimer out there. The first one is just if in your team, and I know you may all follow the Red Book, you may not, but rapid fire, if you could just give me, if you were to rebuild your team, what is your ideal first, second, third hire? Linzee, we'll let you go first.
Yeah. So I actually, now that I've been hiring for as long as I have, I'm going to say I have a little bit of a different take on this than the Red Book is going to say. So I would say your executive assistant first, and then second hire. I love hiring what I call a listing manager, who is somebody who is a smaller salary. They have a percentage of everything they try to help you do, and they take off the inspection negotiations. And they can go to the house for the appraisal. They can go do an open house. You know, they've got to be licensed. That I have seen those two, so that somebody's in the office and somebody's out with you, be really powerful for people.
Awesome. Lance, what's it for you?
So we definitely use the admin assistant as leverage on that first hire. What I would say is whatever you're not good at doing is what you should be hiring. And for us, you know, I was very operations and business minded. Karina was an inside sales mentality. Like, she loves being on the phone. She loves to lead generate. So we utilized both of our assets, and then we needed somebody to do the things that we weren't good at doing. So without knowing it, we followed the MREA book the first several years, and we also utilized our deficits to bring strengths into the business.
Great answer. And Chris, anything to add?
Yeah, I mean, I love both of their answers, because there's like, look, the models are there to give us guidelines, right? They're not the law. They're not like we have to be legalistic about it, right? And I love Lindsay's answer. I love Lance Loken's answer. With the advent of how virtual things are these days, there's a lot of options. And, you know, the first hire we do need to have is somebody that, if you're great at sales, right, it should be somebody that takes the admin stuff off your plate. It should be, you know, all admin, all lead, not lead generation, but marketing, back-end marketing stuff, transaction management as well. But when you look at, like, one of the things I'm running into with my coaching clients is, like, there's a lot of virtual transaction management per transaction help that's out there. And as long as it's good, because there's a lot of bad, as long as it's good, you know, you could supplement with that, like listing specialist, like Lindsay's saying. I definitely agree that it's got to be admin, because here's what happens. If you hire a salesperson next, it's you and then another salesperson, you're both doing the admin and transaction stuff. That's no bueno. You know, if you're good at sales, you should be focused on sales, not the admin. And what is it? Traction and entrepreneurial operating system talks about the visionary and the implementer. Most of us are visionaries. We need the implementer. I know that both Caleb and I are visionaries, right? So we desperately needed an implementer in those. And that's what the admin should be, a systems builder, implementer person.
Awesome. I love that. And for those of you who are listening, EOS, the book Traction, written by Gino Wickman, one of my favorite books of all time. So definitely check into that. So another sort of, this is almost a bad question to ask because it could go so sideways, but people want to know, what are your top two or three lead sources? You're up first, Chris.
All right, cool. We'll keep doing this then. Our database, like our the last, for as long as I can remember, the best source we have is our database. It's been about 60 to 65% of our business consistently. And when you look at the path is in the math, as Gary's been saying lately, and with a database, for every 10 people in your database, you should get one transaction. That's the equation that's floating out there right now. And we're not near that, right? We have like 3,300 people in our database, and you know, we're not getting the numbers out of there. So our 36 plus touch program needs to be better. I think our second one, I'm looking at our dashboard right now, our second one really is prospecting. We've been traditionally a heavily prospecting business. So that's, you know, circle calls, cold calls, you know, that those kind of things. And then our third one would be something like a Dave Ramsey and HomeLight type solutions that we plug into, which does impact our cost of sales, by the way.
So. Yeah, for sure. And I noted you wrote on there, always honor the do not call list. Thanks for that message yes. in the chat. Lance, how about for you?
Yep, our data bank is our number one resource. 30.5% of our business comes from our data bank. 25.8% of our business comes from our national marketing with radio and television. And then 22.6% comes from our new construction. We do quite a bit of business with them.
Awesome. Thanks for that. And I love the tenth of a percent. Doesn't surprise me at all. Linzee, how about you?
I love that he has the percentage. So I'm like, I want to see what my percentages are. and we have them if it would load here. But we are, yeah. So we are database or Sphere is number one for us as well. We're a little bit of a different beast. So people need to remember that. But my agent referrals is number two. We do Ciprani Consulting works with people all over the country. So that's it's become a big one for us. And then sign calls specifically. This year and last year became our number three. So just picking up the phone when people are calling on our listings started to be really big for the last 2 years. So
that last one is amazing because it is free and it is happening. And we so often just don't, you know, the live answer rate, it is a struggle. So really good one. That was three out of three, everybody, by the way, for database. So over and over, if I've interviewed some of the top teams in the country, it is very rare that I don't hear that as a number one lead source. And I can relate to that with our team as well. So, the Red Book, is accurate in that, right? That is good advice. This is a question that a number of people, two or three different people email me. In your entire growth journey, what is one thing to focus on that gave you the most dramatic growth?
I'm first this time, aren't I?
You are. I'm really sorry.
All right. No, I'm good with that, actually. You know what, you guys, leadership is just, I feel like we don't focus on that enough. And so I actually prepped to bring, you know, the John Maxwell, well, all of his books are great for leadership, right? But the five levels of leadership really, I think for some reason, for me, I really love when somebody dumps something down and gives me like steps or a process. That's why I create processes in consulting, right? And so I'm a process nerd. The five levels of leadership was huge for me because I was like, oh, I'm at level three with this person and I'm at level two. And I think it just validated the fact that I had to grow with those people and become their leader. I mean, that's something that you know, what I love about the Lokens is that, I mean, the two of them have like totally grown in leadership over years with their people. And if you talk to their people, I mean, they are live and die, the Lokens. And just, I mean, they have grown to the fifth, you know, level of leadership and with a lot of their people. And so, and then the Ideal Team Player book. So for me, reading has really been a big deal. But this book too, just really gave me a map of like, who do I have on my team and how do I take this to the next level and do I have the right people and do I not? And as a hiring person, I was always like, I'm so good at this. And I'm not, right? None of us are. Mm. But this was a really, really huge, book for me too. So.
Awesome. So leadership and then, five levels of leadership and Ideal Team Player.
Yep. Just focusing on that stuff, hiring Perfect. And leadership.
Lance, one of the things that you could focus on that gave you the most dramatic growth?
So I guess it's a little bit different. I came from corporate America in a retail environment. And so I brought those tools to this industry. And when we sat down that first week in January, I'll never forget it. Karina and I are sitting at the dining room table and I'm writing down our mission, vision, and value statements. And Karina's going, what are you doing? We've got to get out and sell homes. We don't have any money. We got to do this work. I go, I understand that. And we need to make a game plan of what we're going to do over the next 6-7 years in order to look into the future. And she just kept complaining, saying, you're absolutely nuts. And I go, that's okay. For me, I need to have something to go for. So we laid out, we looked at the number one team in Houston, who also happened to be the number one team in Keller Williams in 2011. And they were doing about $225 million in business. So looked at that number and said, okay, so if we want to be number one in Houston by 2017, let's work those numbers backwards. And looked at the first year and looked at number eight, looked like a good number to achieve. And then game planned to hit $250 million by 2017 so that we could be number one. Had no idea how we were going to do that. And at least it gave us a game plan to attack it. The other thing that was really huge is we focused on one thing each year. So the first year we thought, listings was a stupid side of the business because I didn't know any better. So we focused on buyers that first year and we did $8.4 million in business. The second year, I was like, a light bulb goes off. Hey, you should probably be focusing on listings because you could get both sides of the deal. How stupid am I? So we focused on listings the second year and we did $24 million. And then the third year, we focused on getting into new construction and that catapulted us to $84 million. But what I'm trying to get at is we took one thing and focused on it that entire year and then layered on top of it. We didn't replace it. So buyers the first year, sellers the second year, new construction. Then we got into radio and television and then the luxury side of the business and it just layered on top of each other. And that's what's helped us to grow. And we also have our game plan out through 2036 right now because our ultimate goal is to have 15% market share of the Houston metro area. But now I can focus on this year for our business instead of focusing on 2036, where we all want to be tomorrow. It just gives you that sense of confidence. And the other thing that I think was gigantic, when we were out recruiting people, they'd say, well, who's the Loken Group? Here we are. Literally my first transaction, I was recruiting the agent on the other side and told her she needed to join us. And she's going, who are you? And I go, oh, we're the Loken Group. We're going to be number one in Houston in 2017. Oh, great. So how many transactions have you done? Well, you're going to be my first transaction, but we're going to be number one in Houston in 2017. Okay. And she goes, you're absolutely nuts. She was already working on a big team. They've been around for 20 years. I said, I appreciate that. And you need to join us because of this. But we had a game plan and she could see herself in that plan of attack. We were able to hire some really high level people because they were able to see themselves within that world. And I think that was huge for us.
That's amazing. There was so much in there to unpack, but just the idea of the value of a clear long-term game plan that not only you can see, but it's so clear to you that you have the confidence to share that game plan with others and you're not making it up. Like I can tell when you have that game plan, you're able to say with genuine confidence from the heart, yeah, this is what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And it's not like a made up thing. Like I'll show it to you and people can see themselves in that world. And that spells vision to me, right? When you can cast that clear vision off a clear plan, it is super powerful. And then I've heard it from Gary. There's a whole book on it called The One Thing. What I heard in your second thing was just the ability to focus on one thing for a whole year. That is like a big idea that is so hard for us to do, right? We want to do multiple things at once. And almost what I hear was like, it didn't matter as much what the thing was. What probably had more impact was that you allowed yourself to focus on it for a whole year and didn't get distracted.
Correct.
Yeah, really good. Powerful stuff. Chris, most impactful thing that has produced the most dramatic growth?
So I will answer that. However, what you just said about what Lance said, holy cow, did we tend to like get, Doug syndrome, you know, that dog from Up where like the squirrel and like we don't focus on something long enough. We stop right before it becomes really successful. And by giving yourself that time to do that, you actually implement it and actually do it, right? We lose focus way too easily. Now, the one thing I will say for me, and this is not just because I'm a MAPS coach, but it's true. And what I heard Lance say really is a coach, right? Because what Lance was talking about is what a great MAPS coach is going to do for you. They're going to sit you down. They're going to say, where do you want life to be in 5 to 10 years? How do we get there? Let's work backwards. That's exactly what I do with my clients. I know Mike could tell you, like, we do the same thing. Like, where do we need to be? Where do we want to be? Let's work backwards. And then what do we need to do today to make sure that that happens? So for me, I took bold in 2009. My biggest limiting belief has always been I'm not good enough. And I took bold from a wonderful, amazing coach named Michael Ann Byerly. She is a ball buster. And I knew if I hired her as a coach, I would end up like in a loony bin. Literally, she would have been too hard for me. And so I hired a life coach. He would kill me for saying that, but I hired a coach that was not in real estate, worked in them for a year and a half. And that was one of the best things I ever did. It helped me get outside of myself and understand myself. And so hiring a coach is one of the best things you can do to help you, you know, grow from that perspective. And since Lindsay's throwing books out, I'm going to throw 2 books at you. This one, The Road Back to You, all about the Enneagram and yourself. My wife and my family have benefited greatly from this book. I love it. And then for leadership, right, where this is a great one by Jocko Willink, Leadership Strategy and Tactics. And if you're, you know, really what coaching is about is growing as a leader. Like Lindsay had said, you know, we're salespeople, but if you want to have a business, I don't care if it's one employee or 100 like Lance has, you need to work as a leader. That's where you got to grow. And most of us don't grasp the concept that going from an agent, which is a career, to a leader as is a totally different career. And you're starting over from unconscious incompetence when you start over in that role, and you've got to grow. And that it, guys, being a leader, you're putting your ego and your heart on the chopping block every single day. It is the hardest job by far you will ever do. And I know for a fact, Lance and Lindsay would agree with that. So, so get a coach, grow yourself.
Yeah. What, there's so much in there. And what, when we're a successful salesperson, that skill set, you know, what got us from A to B might not get us from B to C is what I hear you saying. And it's a different skill set. And that unconscious incompetence is where you find yourself when you don't study the new skill set and learn from it and master it before you actually take the new thing on. So, you know, I'm making notes of the books you guys are throwing out, and just the wisdom in reading and learning and getting a coach so that you can master those additional skill sets before you take that leap into growing a business where you're responsible for leading other people. That's super valuable. Awesome stuff. We actually skipped to a question, which was, how important is coaching to you? Why or why not? When you said coach, I know you even disclaimed, like, I don't want to be self-serving because I am a coach. But I saw Lance and Lindsay's heads nodding. Before everybody got on the call, I had a short discussion with Lance. Lance, how important is coaching to you? How many coaches do you have right now?
Yeah. So it was funny when Chris was talking, because here we, and I put this in the chat box, we started the business January 2011. We're $250,000 in debt. And by July of 2011, so 6 months into it, we're getting a MAPS coach, because one, we were fighting and getting divorced every day. And second, we needed to have somebody that could help game plan our business. I don't need somebody to hold me accountable. I can do that just fine. I need somebody that I can mastermind with to discuss other opportunities. Karina, she kind of needs more accountability. And that's what the coach was able to do for both of us. Do strategy as well as adapting to accountability for each individual. But we got that in July of 2011, and we've had a MAPS coach ever since. And in fact, our entire exec team has a MAPS coach. We have 12 MAPS contracts that the Loken Group pays for right now. The other piece is, I also, I get coached by 3 people on a weekly basis. And one of them is MAPS. So I believe it's invaluable. The other thing is, everybody's talking about these books. It was funny. I'm not a book reader. In fact, I hate reading books. I can handle Audible to a degree on my way to work. And I have a 42-minute ride to work. So it makes it a good time to do that. But the thing that I will never forget is, I think it was 3 years ago, Gary was doing a mastermind with his top groups, and somebody said, who are your mentors? And he immediately said books. And I was like, wow. And he said, you can have people that you talk to today, but books are what happened in the past, and you can learn from what they learned so that you don't make those same exact mistakes moving forward. And he reads books on a daily basis. From that moment on, I haven't missed a single day of reading a book because of that.
That's awesome. And I heard you have three coaches right now. And if you notice the chat, we're in a coaching competition, by the way, because Chris has five and I'm feeling completely inadequate because I have two and I obviously need more. So that it's amazing though. Obviously they're putting their money where their mouth is. Coaching isn't just important. They have multiple coaches. Linzee, anything to add to that discussion?
I have two coaches. I do feel inadequate too. I feel like I need more right now. but I coach with Craig Goodliff from MAPS, and who has drastically changed my life and my business, and also owns Cyberbacker. So he and I run in similar circles, even though he's in the Philippines. But you know, he has changed my business a ton, and I've remained loyal to him for years and years. And then I also have Susie DeBias, which Chris also has, and she helped me release 60 pounds and just changed my health. And so she's my nutritionist, and I've also been with her for 3 years now. So yeah.
Awesome. Thanks for that. So coaching is powerful. The next question is about processes or systems or models. I'm sort of lumping them all because there was questions around all three of those. So are there any processes or models or systems in your businesses that are absolutely non-negotiable for you? And what are they?
Okay. Whose turn is it?
Lindsay's. Are we going back? All right.
Yeah, we'll stay on it. Stay on that.
Yeah, this is like I'm married to a lot of my processes and systems. In fact, that's what I put in place through our consulting and multiple businesses. But I'm going to say that the one that I've actually, I'll do two. The two that have drastically changed other people's businesses, including mine. One is a daily stand-up. And it doesn't just look like a huddle. It's not like a rah-rah thing. That's very salesy. And I started in operations in this world. So I have an operations angle to mine. And we review, so we'll do something like a script practice right away in the morning, or we'll do our winning Wednesday or motivational Monday. And we have different things for each day. But then we launch into, hey, here's where we are with all of our files, right? And as teams have gotten bigger and we're consulting them, we still put that same stand up in place, but there's different times for different people, depending on how they organize their business, or we do a buyer's one or a seller's one. But it really, it's the thing that has stopped transactions from falling through. And on teams, it's one of the biggest things where, like, you never hear again, I never talk to anybody, right? And especially in the virtual world right now, like if everybody can come together in the morning, be on the same page, talk through their, you know, what they've got going on for the day and the important dates in their files, and then move on for the day, your team members really feel like, okay, the operations team knows exactly where we are and what they need from me. And they've got one morning where they can just go, you know, I need all these things. And then the ops people can go and take it from there. That's been huge for all of the businesses that we've consulted in, including mine. And then I would say too, like just having a solid, you know, five or six lead plans that are just awesome, that are always triggered when you bring somebody in, dependent on source, right? So I use Brivity. I'm a big Brivity fan. And then, you know, so if somebody has an open house, they'll come in, they're going to put it in. And we actually, operations people put it in because I know salespeople, and I have my ops team do all the things, but they're going to put it in. And then as soon as they put that the source is an open house buyer or an open house nosy neighbor is one of ours, boom, it triggers a plan that just goes. And you know, having the five or six different lead plans, which if anybody wants that, email me, I'll get them to you, that are really solid that you can use all the time, have been really gold for us.
Awesome. So lead plans for each lead source and daily standups. Thanks for that. Lance, what are yours?
The systems that people are going to use.
Good answer.
At the end of the day, like for me, in the first 4 years of business, I use spreadsheets. Like, I live on spreadsheets. If you look at my screen right now, I have a gaming screen that's about 3 feet wide, and I have three spreadsheets across it, and then I have my emails on the side. Anyhow, I'm completely systems and processes minded. And so we use spreadsheets the first 4 years. And then our success team started saying, okay, this is getting old. We can't operate in your kind of world anymore. We need to do something. And they brought in Trello, and Trello was absolutely amazing. We also had Infusionsoft, which was the back end system. We got into Infusionsoft, one, because we wanted something that was going to handle doing 100,000 transactions a year, because that's where we were looking for. Also, we talked with Greg Harrelson, which was with Century 21, and he utilized Infusionsoft at a really high level. So we invested in that. Now, fast forward, we were really hoping that Command would get to the level that we needed to, and we helped them along the way every step that we could. It just hasn't been conducive for the team of our size. So we invested in Property Base, and we spent about 9 months getting Property Base together and working. And so we went live February 15th, and it was a real big challenge because people weren't adapting. They were so used to Trello and absolutely loved Trello. So we got to the point on March 1st, we turned off Trello and said, look, you don't have a choice anymore. And we know it, we're creatures of habit. So if you have the ability to go something that you're comfortable with or something that you're uncomfortable with, what are you gonna do? So we shut off Trello, and it has been the best thing in the world. I'm telling you, Property Base and what Elena has done, she's our VP of operations. What Elena has done with Property Base will blow your mind, like the capabilities and stuff. And it talks back and forth with Infusionsoft. So it's been great. But at the end of the day, whatever systems you have, make sure that you use them to the capabilities that you have.
I love that. And Lance, I'm watching our team's wonderful operations folks that are on this call. And when you said turn off Trello, I saw her mind explode. And so we're going to set that on the table and come back to it later. But I totally get what you're saying. And I appreciate the answer to the question, because of your team's size, you know, a different system is not necessarily going to work for another team size. And as you grow, you use the system that you will use, not necessarily what somebody else is using. Chris, what is it for you?
Goodness gracious, there's so many things that we could say, but I think about lead dominoes. And like, okay, I don't care if you're a solo agent or if you have a business where you have at least one other teammate or employee, you need to have some sort of scoreboard that tells you what's going on, right? There's this accountability, this thing called accountability feedback loop. When I teach business planning clinic, right, it goes over that where you start with setting goals, you take the action, you measure your actions. And then from there, you analyze and say, hey, what's going on? Is it working? Is it not working? What changes do we need to make? And then you set new goals. And if you don't know where you're at, right? If you don't understand where you're at in all of those things, you're never going to be able to make changes, right? So the scoreboard that, you know, similar to Lance, scoreboard that I have simply is based off the four conversations, but you know, it's appointments held, agreements, pendings, closings, and then profit and GCI. So like, where should we be? Where are we? And then, you know, based on the gap, like I can make informed decisions as the CEO of where we need to shine the spotlight and what we need to do. And the same thing goes for your finances. If you guys haven't listened to Think Like a CEO season 5 that came out in February, oh, please listen to that. It's all about wealth building. And I just recently, like this past weekend, created a profit and loss for my family. And that's been eye-opening. You know, I've had it for my business, but if you don't have it for yourself, literally a profit and loss for your family every month, and then for the last 12 months running, it's eye-opening. And so having those scoreboards to understand where you're at, we talked about awareness before, and you got to be aware of those things. So that's, I could talk a lot about that. But
yeah, and that's what a P&L is, right? It's a bit of a scoreboard, right? And it's not, mm-hmm. Yeah. And your scoreboard doesn't need to be complicated, but having, as Lance said, mm-hmm. having something to shoot.
It shouldn't be complicated.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be complicated. It should be simple. Keith Cunningham's a great author that talks a lot about that stuff. Sorry, Dave.
No problem. I agree completely. I tend to overcomplicate everything. So, and then nobody understands the scoreboard because it's too complicated. So, Really good for me to hear. So we have about 9 minutes left, and I want to honor you guys' time. This has been amazing. I want to try to do a rapid fire to get through a couple of these last questions that people have been asking. And some of these are going to be hard to do rapid fire, but do your best. So what is the top skill set? I think you already answered it. Top skill set to master if you're going to focus on growing a team. Chris?
It's hard. Leadership and hiring.
Leadership and hiring. Lance, anything different?
Nope. You got to hire the right people.
Leadership and hiring. Okay.
Don't hire for today's business. Hire for the next 3 to 5 years business, because today's business is going to be short term. Looking for what you want to accomplish 3 to 5 years and hiring to that, that's where it makes a big difference.
Linzee, to grow a team, any other skill sets other than leadership and hiring? Are those the two most important?
They are. And that's why I created the leadership equation to study leadership. And then why I have a hiring company, because I really wanted to figure out how to do that well. So here we are.
Awesome. Yeah. So plug for Linzee. She's good at that. Also, Keller Williams has an amazing course called Career Visioning. If you haven't taken it, it's definitely worth everyone's while. Been super impactful for me. Another one, Linzee, starting with you. We have a lot of independent agents who are worked to the core and are struggling with, I don't want to let go. Do you have any advice for them?
Let go. No, but I mean, seriously, it's really crazy. That's why career visioning matters, right? To go and to learn and to, you know, learn how to find somebody. Or if you're not going to take the time because you're so busy as an independent contractor, then, you know, call somebody like me. There's other companies too. But, you know, the truth is, you have to let go, because that's, I mean, your whole family is going to suffer. And truly, that's what matters. Like, if we didn't learn from everything last year in 2020, if we didn't learn what's important to us, then I don't know how we will. But we need to spend time with the people that we love. And so I just, you know, I implore you, please let go. And if you can't do it, start with a transaction coordination business. Very easy, like call a TC business. I love Cipros. And I mean, there's a lot of little tiny ones, right? Email me, I'll introduce you, but just let go of some of it, right?
Yeah, awesome. Anything different from Lance or Chris on that one?
Don't build a team then, if that's the mindset that you have, that you're the ceiling, because all of a sudden you're the lid in your organization. The other key part is you're being selfish if you don't want to give up that control, because the whole reason you have a business or a team is to grow them, not grow yourself. And until you get that mentality that you're here for them, then don't do it.
It's a powerful perspective shift.
And I'll just add this, look, not everybody should grow a huge team like we have, like Lance, Linzee, and myself have. And it's okay, right? What's your life by design? Being a solo agent with no help is the hardest job in the entire world. Please don't do that to yourself. Don't do that to your family. In my opinion, everybody should have at least a rockstar admin, period. End of story. Licensed. That can help you in this state, should be licensed. So please, please don't do that to yourself.
Thanks, Chris. Next one is, this came up a number of times, and I think maybe that a lot of people have this unicorn idea of what a team should look like. And you just said, Bill, not every team should be a huge team. You know, life, what do you want? What are your goals? Is a seventh level team, is that possible? Does it exist? Is it common? You know, how long does it take to get there? Tell us about that journey.
I'll start first, since we're going this back and forth thing. Yes, they exist. You know, they exist all over the place. You know, I'm on a sixth level, and honestly, I don't intend to step out of that anytime soon, because I love the leadership aspect. I love the people aspect of it. You know, even when you're seventh level and you have a CEO running your team, you still have to like put your finger on the pulse on a regular basis. You can't just step away and let it be mailbox money. It doesn't work that way. Gary said that. And so yes, it is. And how long does it take? How long do you want it to take? Right. You know, I forget who was saying it, but like it used to take a long time. Now it's like it used to take 10 years and it was 5, 2.5. You know, there's people who are doing it in less than 2.5 years. So it's possible. You just have to follow the model, get a great coach, be humble and go for it.
Awesome. Anything to add, Lance?
For me personally, just like Chris said, I have no interest in being a seventh level person, because I owe it to our team to be invested in them. I mean, we've worked so hard those first 5 years to grow the business to where it is today. I hated real estate for the longest time. I hated people. I hate talking to people. Like, real estate is not something I should have gotten into. And so for 5 years, hating what you did to get to the point now where I absolutely love the people in our organization. I love serving them. We, Karina and I, wake up every day to build this organization large enough to encompass all of their dreams and their aspirations. So I feel like I owe it back to them. That's my two cents.
I love it. I love it. Linzee, anything on that?
So I feel like it wouldn't be fair for me to not be super transparent and authentic here. I'm the same way. I didn't love real estate. I loved running the business, building the business, creating all that stuff, hence having a consulting company. You know, I want to challenge all of you guys. I think there's a bunch of people that come into real estate and they're entrepreneurial and they have an ego attached to them, right? Whether we like it or not, there's an ego there. And I was never somebody who needed my name on a sign or any of those things. I want to challenge you, if you're struggling and you're really burnt out, like, you're going to see something happen with me and my team very soon, where I think there's a lot of teams that should be coming together to be bigger and better and to do big things in the world and to push to be awesome together. And I think solo agents can do that too. And so I'm a huge proponent of the team aspect. I think dropping our ego and doing what's best for our teams and best for us, somebody who doesn't want to be in the leadership all the time for all that stuff, I'm trying to figure some of that out for my own team. So there's that.
It's awesome. Guys, we have 2 minutes. I want to get this last question out, and it may encompass something you already said, which is totally fine. I just want to bookend the conversation. There's a bunch of people on here, and this has been so, so valuable. In the area of building a business, whether it's a solo agent, getting that additional leverage to get some time back with their family and bringing that opportunity to somebody else, or whether it's a bigger business growth journey, if you could just give one piece of advice to somebody listening, that's the most important overall piece of advice, what is it?
That means I have to go first, right? Gosh, the one piece of advice, I think I'm just going to piggyback off of what I just said. I think that the moment that you drop your ego and figure out what you want your life to look like, right? How much money do you really want to make? How, you know, do you want to be in leadership? Do you want to be meeting with those people every single day to see what their lives need to look like, right? And how it fits within your world? Or do you want to just sell a lot of houses and you really love it and you just are a really good salesperson? Like, figure out where you're passionate and what you're really good at, and then figure out what that looks like. So it might mean that you hire somebody for yourself, right? As a admin, it might mean that you partner with somebody or you go into a team. You know, there's so many different options there, but I just want to challenge people to get rid of the ego and say, what's going to, you know, make my life and my family's life the best.
Awesome. Lance, a final word?
Holding people accountable to their motivation or their goals. I don't think people own accountability well enough. Like, it's not negotiable, because they've come to you and they've asked to work with you and your business. You need to hold them accountable to what they want to achieve. And at the end of the day, they leave because they're not truly being held accountable.
Yeah, accountability brings freedom. It's an oxymoron, but it's true. So good. Chris, final word from you?
I'm going to shift what I said. I had something for the solo agent out there that might be struggling to make things happen. I'm going to say this. Keep your promises to yourself. Here's what I mean by that, is that all of us tend to be able to keep our promises to other people. We'll never let other people down. But when we let ourselves down, we start to trust ourselves a little bit less, a little bit less, a little bit less, until we really have no dignity. We don't respect and honor ourselves. And when that happens, that's when you start gaining weight or getting unhealthy or letting things slide, getting depressed like I did in my early 20s. Please, you know, if you have a hard time with that, get a coach, get a counselor, whatever you need to make sure that you're keeping your promise to yourself. Anything's possible. Anything's possible. That's accountability, right? So understand your word with yourself and really, really make that right. Because for me, back in 2009, 2010, when I hired that coach, that's what he helped me do. He helped me see that I couldn't keep my word to myself at all. And if you can do that, nothing is nothing's impossible. So,
so good, you guys. I have a page of notes. I know I was seeing the chat blow up with gratitude from you guys. I want to honor your time. It's 1 minute after two. Can everybody on here just give the panel a huge Zoom clap if you could? Lance, Linzee, and Chris, we appreciate you guys, all your wisdom and all your insight, and everybody for being on the call today. I hope you have a great rest of your week, and we will see you guys later.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you guys. See ya.
See you guys later.